I'm a laptop with a busted display. Because of my LCD, nobody really sees my value on eBay. Well, I do. So here's a Samsung i5 system, model number NP300V5A. I got it for 10 bucks plus shipping in an auction that was not Buy It Now. Reason why I got it for that price is because the screen was broke, the keyboard was non-responsive, and the seller didn't include a power supply or anything like that. So after testing it, I did have a keyboard that externally worked, so that was something. And I replaced the screen. Now the screen's an interesting story. Right there, you can see what is almost a replacement. This is a 15.4 inch screen. The original one took a 15.6 inch screen, which is there. Now you can get away with this a lot of the time, but the problem was there was no separate connection for the inverter. This one had the red and white wire connection for the inverter, and this one did not. This just had the display thing. So, went to the drawing board, and in this bag here, I had a 14-inch screen that did not have the inverter connection, just the display connection, and that works. So now this has a screen that I've jury-rigged on there with some black duct tape. I did have some extra RAM laying around, so being a second generation i5, I was able to take this up to 16 gigabytes of RAM. Oh, you might be asking, how could I write off the 16 gigabytes of RAM? Why wasn't I factoring in the cost? Well, I vlogged a while back about the situation where Amazon warehouse deals had one stick of 8 gigabytes on sale for 15 bucks, and I got it, and they sent me a box of 10 of them. So I got 9 extra sticks for that. So I got 10 8 gigabyte sticks of laptop RAM for 15 bucks. So that's how I can write it off as a non-cost. Lucky me. Keep looking for those deals though. They are out there. Just have to be persistent. Persistent and savvy, I should say.
I've disassembled it because I wanted to check the keyboard connection, which is this cable here. Now it's very odd because if I start it up and I press F2 really fast, it can sometimes go into BIOS with the keyboard that it has, but the directional cables and stuff don't work. So I've disconnected and reconnected the keyboard cable a couple of times with pretty much the same results. So I am led to think that the damage that destroyed the screen was some sort of crush damage that made the keyboard mostly non-responsive. So I'm not going to invest, you know, more than I paid for this thing in getting a keyboard replacement so it can be used with an external keyboard. What I want to do now, after I, you know, wanted to make sure it had the wireless card, so that's another benefit to taking the case off to check the keyboard cable, I want to check the fan heatsink and vent area to make sure there is no conglomeration of dust. I was able to confirm that the fan works, and so we're going to get a look at the CPU heatsink assembly. Okay, so it wasn't terrible, but there was a collection of dust, as you can see here up in the corner, and there's still some there. Also, take a look at this scattershot thermal compound application on the CPU. Holy crap, this is pretty much spilled onto the motherboard there. And on the bottom of the heatsink, you can see there too, we have lost containment. Alright, so I'm going to clean this up and put it back on. Okay, someone needs to tell the Samsung thermal compound department that more does not necessarily equal better. Got this one cleaned up, and I'm assuming they used a really good thermal compound, Arctic Silver, something like that. So instead of using my Big Bertha generic crappy one, Have you seen Big Bertha? She's around here somewhere. Hey, Big Bertha, what you got cooking? There she is. This is really generic, and it's a little watery at times. So I took a huge hunk that was just sitting in the corner of this stuff, and I put it on the CPU. And I think I'd prefer doing that than super watery, well, a less inferior compound on an i5. So if anything goes wrong, I've got the Samsung thermal compound remnant to blame. It's my story, and I'm sticking to it. So here's what a 14-inch screen looks like in place of a 15.6-inch screen. Instead of doing, I was contemplating silicone adhesive on the back, but then I thought, you know, if there's any trouble, it's going to be a pain in the ass. So I just did black duct tape around the edges there. Good old duct tape, Red Green's favorite tool. And it stuck on fine, and I've sealed up the back. I've put in a spare 320 gigabyte, 7200 RPM hard drive that I had. I had to find a cover for the RAM, so this is off of a Dell D820. And it should be alright. I'm going to have to reinstall the operating system, and we'll see how it goes. So here she is in action. The biggest benefits, I think, are the 16 gigs of RAM, the second generation i5, and from BIOS it wasn't particularly clear if it was a standalone video or if it was part of the chip, so that would be another discovery. Usually with these models, you know, something like NVIDIA Quadro or something, but it could be part of the chip for all that I know, Intel GMA. So, I'm using an external DVD drive because the one that was in there was making some horrendous noises, and it was making like some sort of, you know, chugga chugga oompa loompa chugga chugga oompa loompa sort of sound. And the expanding Windows file stayed at zero after a couple minutes, so it said it wasn't able to read the drive after I tried to cancel it. So I think maybe there's some sort of warp thing going on there. The drive was certainly recognized, and it certainly got to the installation for Windows point. It was just the expanding Windows files that seemed to be a big old conundrum for it. So, we'll be installing it from the external drive, and I'm thinking, you know, what the hell, go for the immediate upgrade to Win10. I haven't put Windows 10 on any system that I would use regularly, but I have tried it out a little bit. This would be the closest that I've come to actually putting on a system that I would use every now and then. Just think it'd be a media server for my daughter or something like that. And so I know how Windows 7 works on this particular model. I have another one just like it that's an i3 with 16 gigs. So Windows 10 on this particular model would be, I don't know, initially fun to observe, but of course I could be seriously put down depending on how the thing performs. I've read a lot of forums where, you know, you have older video cards, ATI, AMD, NVIDIA stuff, and the drivers, you know, Windows 10 will install its basic Windows video driver, which will suck compared to the native drivers for those cards. And usually there's no way to work around that, but I've read some forums where you can specifically go to the Microsoft database and download these drivers and then tell Windows 10 to use these drivers, or, well, with a second generation i5, that should not be a problem. Another incentive to try out Windows 10 on this thing. And when I opened up the notebook that I had this in, it was a Compaq, I think it was a 6515B. It was a Turion 64 dual core system with 4 gigs of RAM. One of my big project systems that I replaced, you know, most of the major components on. And I thought, okay, well, I really don't want to, you know, have to take this out, but I also don't want to have to spend $20-$30 on a drive. So I made myself a deal. I said, if it's a 7200 RPM drive, I'll put it in the i5, and if not, it can stay with the Turion 64 dual core. And it was a 7200 RPM drive. So,
setup, updating registry settings.
as if that particularly matters at this point. Another thing with Windows, as long as we're in the wrap stage here, a lot of users, and I've read this in forums, and I was really relieved to find out that I wasn't the only one, a lot of users have had problems downloading Windows Update. They'll install Windows 7, and they'll activate it and all that, and then updates will take forever. You'll be there the whole day, and it's still searching for updates with no results. And there are some forums that said, oh, well, you got to update Internet Explorer to do that. And then I've tried, you know, Microsoft.net and then the Microsoft Fix-It tool. And then there's an actual update that Microsoft did to address update problems. So different people have had different results. There doesn't seem to be one unifying fix for it. But what people have noticed is that since Windows 10 became available, suddenly Windows 7 fresh install updates are pushed way back in the attic, and you just wait forever for them. So if you're having that problem, don't feel alone. It's common as far as I understand. Completing installation. Well, again, this was a $10 system plus shipping. And they wanted $18 for shipping, and I found out why. It wasn't that they were trying to get some extra bucks on shipping. It was that they used a large flat rate priority box when this particular notebook, and most notebooks, unless you got a huge 17-inch honker, will fit into a medium flat rate priority box. And the difference there is, you know, over $5. So that's where the little extra charge came in. I should have gotten this thing for like $22, but instead it was more like $28. But still, $10 plus the covering shipping, and it's there, you know. It even came with a couple of gigs of RAM, but whatever the hell that's worth, right? And the Wi-Fi was in there, you know. Somebody had tried to do a number on this thing. It must have been when the keyboard wasn't working, somebody tried to pry it apart, and the grill for the heatsink, you know, was sort of off, and it's a little warped. It's showing its age, but it's working, so not going to complain. Okay, Windows 7 is activated, and I've slipped in the install disk for Windows 10. And now, with as much junk that I could find taken off of Windows 10, let's see the startup time. Here's the Samsung. 12 seconds. Not too bad. And there is a lot of automatic stuff that you're going to want to take off unless you enjoy being tracked and recorded by Microsoft. But other than that, it's a snappy operating system, and it's a lot more of a familiar interface than Windows 8 was. So, for $10 in the auction, plus the shipping, we have a i5 second generation laptop with 16 gigabytes of RAM. I put in a 7200 RPM 320 gigabyte hard drive, had to take down the screen size from 15.6 to 14, but other than that, I mean, spare parts I had lying around, it cost $28 for an i5 with 16 gigabytes of RAM. So that's pretty cool. Stay tuned to the channel, and I'll post some more computer repair adventures. And at the risk of jinxing myself, I don't want to do this on a deal I haven't received yet, but I want to show you one from within the past 12 hours. This is from Warehouse Deals. It's not them directly. It's a seller on Warehouse Deals. I got three of these. You notice they're white label 500 gigabyte notebook hard drives. They list a bunch of different models here, but it doesn't matter. If it's a 2.5-inch drive, it can fit in most notebooks. All the models here, sometimes they have a harness that go with them that'll help with those models. But other than that, it's a fine drive for $8.25 a piece. 500 gigabyte notebook hard drive. So yeah, they're out there. persistent and savvy.